Congratulations, you've joined the Showrunner Marketing Podcast, a network of accomplished businesswomen who are running the show. Here, you'll find the inspiration and the inside information you need to take your marketing strategies to the next level. Bringing her thirst for continued learning and her 25 years of experience as founder and president of ad agency Advanced Marketing Strategies, here's your host, Kathy Cunningham.
Hi, everybody. It's Kathy. And today we're talking with Melissa Griffin. She's the owner and business strategy consultant at MRG Consulting. And she's the vice president, retired, of Stater Brothers Market. And she ran the service deli and bakery department. Melissa has over 30 years of experience in marketing, branding, and strategy. As vice president, she headed the service deli and bakery division of Stater Brothers, a legacy brand and Southern California-based supermarket chain with annual sales in excess of $4 billion. The breadth of her experience across disciplines like market share optimization, private label branding, pricing and forecasting, advertising promotions, digital analytics, demographic marketing, retail shelf space negotiation, food styling, training, point of sale and merchandising, there's so much more. It's exhausting to read, and it's also remarkable. Recently retired from Stater Brothers, Melissa has transitioned into her own consulting business, MRG Consulting, and is helping companies find their way in the new retail environment. As a fellow of the University of Redlands' prestigious Whitehead Leadership Society, Melissa continues to grow and serve her community. She is also a self-proclaimed foodie, and she enjoys international travel and experiencing delightful cuisines abroad. Oh my goodness. Melissa, welcome to the Showrunner Network.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
It's fantastic. And I tell you, I only read probably, a third of your background. And I know there's just so much more and so much experience that you bring to our conversation today. So thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
I think what I'd like to do is start by having you tell us a bit more about your professional journey and your background in the retail marketing business.
All right. Well, I started in the industry as a courtesy clerk. Back in the day, they called it a box person.
Oh, my goodness.
Pushing carts and bagging groceries. Huh. And I was fortunate enough to work for Stater Brothers Markets, who our CEO, chairman, at the time was Jack Brown, also the owner of the company. Ah. And he believed in promoting the majority of the company from the bottom up. So I would say 95% of our leaders had served in that position. And he felt it was critical. It's critical for you to know how to serve others in order to be a servant leader. Mm. And that was the model that he set and mentored for us. So I worked at store level for 6 years in various capacities, checker, service deli, bakery, cake decorator, baker, and then ultimately, department head in a couple of different areas of the store. And that experience gave me just a real appreciation for the nuts and bolts of the store from one end to the other. And I had an opportunity to go corporate after 6 years as a marketing merchandiser. That was a great experience. It taught me the art of merchandising. And you need to have eye appeal for buy appeal.
Ooh.
And then I worked into the retail operations fields of supervision. And so I spent a lot of time in the retail ops area, although my expertise reported under marketing. So it was really kind of nice. I got the best of both worlds. I got to experience operations and all that's involved with that, but also got all of the analytical expertise and marketing expertise that comes with reporting out of the marketing division. I moved up to marketing specialist and then marketing director, retail operations, service deli bakery, and then to director, service deli bakery, and then ultimately vice president. So it's been a great journey, but along the way, I also got to wear quite a few different hats. I put together our company's first food safety program, working with San Bernardino County, the largest county in the country, and put together a food safety program with them, and then ultimately built a food safety program for Stater Brothers. And that was critical because when you're dealing with food, you're dealing with food safety, that's your brand. And it's so important that you handle it safely and that you protect your branding. So it was a great opportunity for me to venture into another capacity within our market. So
really protecting the brand through food safety.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It was critical, because if we reflect back to Jack in the Box back in the 80s, what happened to them, they had 13 people die associated with some food that was served. And you don't ever want that to happen with your brand. You could be destroyed overnight. And so food safety when you're dealing with selling groceries is critical.
Well, what a storied tale that was, to start in the very beginning from bag girl all the way to vice president. My goodness, that's the American dream.
Yes.
And wonderful to be tutored underneath the owner, Jack Brown, right? Was that what you said?
Yes, yes.
Fantastic. Well, I think what would be very interesting is to have you describe maybe the most significant marketing lesson you learned at the helm of the Soverson Deli Bakery Division.
Well, I would have to say that probably the most important lesson that I learned was servant leadership. And the reason for that is that people don't care what you know until they know you care. And when you're getting out there and you are leading by example and you're working with your people, that's what's critical about getting a team together that will execute. You have to recall that you always have two ears and one mouth. So when you lead, you need to listen more than you speak to your people. And just respecting the people that work for you, treating them like team members, not talking down to them, is probably, probably the most successful lesson that I learned, was because my team, the respect went both ways, and they would have bent over backwards before they let me down. Never, ever did I ever have to ask anybody to stay over or work through their lunch or come early. They did it when they knew it needed to be done. And that to me was a nice, a real reward, showing, I was doing the right thing with my team.
Right, right. Great lesson.
Being demanding,
Right. Well, retail in general is rapidly changing right now. How is the traditional grocery store landscape changing?
It is changing dramatically.
Yes, I know. Hold on tight.
Yeah. And you have to be on top of your game. You really have to make sure that you are studying the landscape of, your territory, because it is changing rapidly. And if we just reflect over probably the last 30 years that I've been in this industry, in my marketplace, there was probably 30 plus different grocers in industry, and the majority of them were your traditional unionized grocers. And now when we take a look at it in this marketplace of Southern California, we're down to, just basically three other operators that reflect the traditional grocer model. And, that would be your Albertsons, your Vons, and your Ralph's company. What really changed the market first, the first disruptor, was Walmart selling groceries. They came in and it just changed the way everybody went to market. The big box store mentality soon spread to Target. And then you have big box stores like Costco. That's a business model that's a definite disruptor. Right. But when we look at what those did to the playing field, it really changed how you had to go to market. And what did the customer want? And you really had to be in tune with your consumer base. So now that was the first wave of it. The next wave that came was you have operators like Trader Joe's and Aldi's and Sprouts that really changed the dynamics of your traditional smaller operating stores. So now we went away from unionized operations, and now we've gone into price operators. Like Aldi, a price operator. But then you have the uniqueness of a Trader Joe's, which is, really targeting more of the world traveler and restaurant experience shopping experience. So it's unique and it's different. They're tapping into different niches. But with Aldi coming in, the size of them and little in the marketplace. Those, I think, are going to be our biggest disruptors currently that are hitting our market, because they are able to really data. It's obvious that they're doing a lot of data mining, their selection, their marketing. I noticed in our Southern California market, when they first came in, they were very plain looking, really unimpressive. They caught on that hurt their marketing. I just saw they opened a new store in Redlands, California, and they changed their whole image. It's very fresh. It's got a nice appeal for millennial markets. You know, just really relevant. They really, you know, have refined their look. They caught on to that in this marketplace, and they offer the best of the best at probably one of the best prices that you can get. They just do this massive purchasing, negotiate with a lot of the large companies to provide items that are so close to brand that you, when I cut them side by side, I can't even tell the difference between them. So very impressive. Yeah. So, but they're able to do it at a much lower price. So that's why they're going to be such a dynamic disruptor. Mm-hmm. And Lidl kind of follows that same pattern. And then we must all, you know, the sleeping giant here would be Amazon. with you know, just their prime services are incredible. It really has eroded the core products in the grocery, all dry products, all, you know, HBA products that you'd normally be carrying in your grocery stores. That's been a, you know, a real disruptor. And then they purchased Whole Foods. With the purchase of Whole Foods, now they have a fresh hub distribution center available to them across the United States. And then when you factor in new services of click and collect that everybody's test marketing, and you look at services like Instacart, how do you compete as a normal traditional grocer and protect your market share? So that's how dynamically it has changed.
Wow. Wow. Thank you for walking us through that. That was really fascinating. So we started with the big box. When Walmart started that, so everybody changed to the big box mentality. Then we went the opposite way to the smaller stores that were price opportunities like Sprouts, and you mentioned Trader Joe's that were really, really niche about world travelers and specific kind of food. And then we talk about the littles and the data driven, and then all the way even down to Amazon and now the Instacart. We are really, I mean, this market is changing. Just flipped on its head. Crazy.
Yes, absolutely. That's a good way to term it.
Wow, that was really interesting. Thank you for walking us through that transition. You know, another really big transition, not only in the supermarket business, but really touching everybody's business and marketing right now, is the internet and social media. Communication is changing so rapidly. Do you have a favorite marketing or communication innovation? And how are you using it?
I would say in grocery industry, you have to get digital. You have to get digital if you're going to survive, especially, you know, when you take into account Instacart and click and collect and Amazon, you really don't have a choice. And when you study, a big part of what I do is I study demographics. So when you study the influence of demographics, you have your baby boomers are they're aging out of the market. That used to be the elephant share of your shopper, but now with them aging and unfortunately passing on, your largest group now, your largest market is not your Gen X, but it's actually your millennial market. They're your biggest market share. So what are they driven by? They're driven by digital media. They all have a screen in front of their face, a tablet in front of their face. That's how they shop. That's how they communicate. And so you really, as you know, as a marketer, have to tap into that, have to realize that, and have to use those channels. And I'd have to say one of my favorites is probably, I would say Instagram. Instagram is really targets that market. So that's probably right there. That's what I would recommend.
Well, and Instagram has such a great opportunity for visuals, which I would imagine is something that you're very interested in.
Yeah, absolutely. Definitely. You know, like I said, eye appeal, buy appeal, right?
Eye appeal, buy appeal. Yes.
Yeah. That gives you that instant gratification. You can feel it. You can almost touch it. So
yeah,
good channel.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting when you took us through the whole history of supermarketing and how it's changed. You know, Stater Brothers is such an iconic brand, and it's a brand we're so proud of here in California. What were some of the strategies that you and your team used to keep this legacy brand fresh and relative during all of this change?
I would once again have to take that back to our late Jack Brown, his leadership style. He was a true partner with vendors and community. Mm. So he modeled that for us, and he didn't just speak it. If you research what Charities does for Stater Brothers, it's very impressive. And he really cared about the communities that he was in. He cared about the communities we were doing business with. He cared about the people that he worked with. He'd walk into a grocery store and there's a courtesy clerk, and he'd go into the back of each department and shake their hands. And so he really set the model for care about what's going on around you. And so he influenced store managers to do the same thing, and they do that with their customers. Their employees reach their customers, and it's that community networking that really has made a difference. If you're that close with your marketplace, you know what your customer wants, and that allows you to stay fresh and relevant. If you've got great vendor business partners and relationships, and you respect the people you do business with, then they're going to be bringing you the latest and greatest of everything. So we always had, you know, a lot of positive support and resources that allowed us to do that. Another big part of that success was, because it was a privately owned company, it was very flat as far as the levels go of hierarchy. So it wasn't like if you were in the bottom and you had an idea, it could never make its way to the top. I'd walk into different stores and I'd have a person come up to me and say, "Hey, Melissa, I've got this idea. I created this, you know, I was in the bakery and I was playing around and I created this new cake or, you know, these new rolls. What do you think?" And it's like, "I think it's great. Let's go ahead and implement it and roll it out." You didn't have all this red tape. So you really had a lot of innovation and people resources. So if you don't have a lot of red tape that you have to go through, you really can tap into your people as genius resource and grow your market share.
Wow. And it all stemmed again from Jack Brown and his values of really leaning into the vendors and the communities. And I like how you were talking about being close to the market and the flat hierarchy that allowed you to take advantage of ideas from the people that were closest to your customers.
Yes.
Right?
Yes, absolutely. It was critical. And normally you wouldn't see that. You wouldn't, you know, the amazing thing is that we valued it. Because some people see it, but they just walk right by it.
Yes, yes. And it sounds like it's sort of the family-run business with Jack at the helm. And it reminds me a lot, we were talking earlier when, you know, we worked with Henry Boney's of Henry's Marketplace. And they had a family-run business with the sons, Stan and Scott, and then later on bringing in Sean, their son. And they really grew that business incredibly too. And now hearing you talk about how that works, they're so close to the community. There's not a lot of hierarchy, and you're able to really grow that brand and keep it relevant because you're so close to everything that's happening. You're so close to your community and your vendors, and it makes a lot of sense.
Absolutely. Absolutely. It's unique, you know, and it's, like you said, it's old fashioned. What was really neat too was Jack Brown was born in San Bernardino, California. And so when he ended up becoming the president of Stater Brothers, he eventually purchased the company to where he was the sole owner of it, but he stayed working until practically his last day because he cared about the people he called us all his family. And he says, "I can't retire because you guys are my family and I have to take care of you." And that was just, you know, you go to work every day. How do you feel when somebody feels that way about you? And when we acquired, the 43 Lucky's and Albertson stores in the Southern California market, instead of letting all the people go or bringing them on and, you know, ignoring who they were, Jack said, "Guess what? You're part of the family now. Pull a chair up to the table. I'm going to honor your years of service. I'm going to honor your vacation. I'm going to honor everything that you've got. And it all comes with you."
Oh, nice.
And I mean, that really is like, you know, adopting them in as part of the family. They were adoptees, but and it was this very successful acquisition as well, which is kind of unheard of with that, you know, large of a acquisition.
Yeah, that's definitely not the kind of stories that we hear about mergers and acquisitions when they just cut all the fat and let everybody go and destroy the brand, right?
Right, right.
Sell it off in pieces. That's a wonderful story. Boy. You know, is there a, with all your branding background and this wonderful iconic brand, is there a brand or two that you follow that you think is doing an exceptional job at marketing? And what kind of lessons can we learn from them?
I would have to say that in the grocery industry, I think probably the ones that stand out to me is going to be Trader Joe's and, mm-hmm. and Costco. I think they do a really good job of being relevant and current with trends and wants and needs. And when we look at the grocery industry, everybody is competing for stomachs. Okay. So part of what helped, you know, erode some market share is all the fast foods and restaurant growth that we've had. And, you know, you can drive 30 years ago, you had a McDonald's, a KFC, and, you know, maybe just a handful of places. Now you have Chipotle's, you have, you know, the Habit Burger, you have, Panda Express, you just have a multi Starbucks, you know, coffee used to be bought at grocery stores, Starbucks. Right. So as you're competing to stay relevant, how do you compete when all of those resources are being stripped from your basket, your grocery basket? Right. And so what Trader Joe's does a nice job with is that they really go after those restaurant experience and trending experience that you would have elsewhere, and actually causes you to drive to their store for that versus going into a restaurant or having to go someplace. You can take that and bring it into your home. So I think that's kind of a unique niche that they have in the market. And I also think Costco with their treasure hunt mentality, you know, they bring new items in there. And when you think about the average grocery ring, I believe last time I looked at the statistics, I think it was around $37 was the average grocery ring in grocery stores. Okay. And then, but when you look at Costco, they have the reputation of being called the $300 store. Whoa. So when you look at, you go, how do they do that? Well, they sell a jumbo sized chicken for $5, and it costs more than that to even sell a chicken that size. They take about a $25 to $30 million loss annually on that item. And you're like, well, that doesn't make sense. You're going to spend $25-$30 million to give away this chicken. But guess what? If you go in with a chicken, you may walk out with a $700 TV. So the people are going there for the chicken, or they're going there for the gas, or their food market, and they're leaving with a basket that's generally, you know, it's known as the $300 store. So we're not really too sure. We don't have that private information on what their basket rings are. But if you go in there and you look at the baskets, talk to people, you know, most people can't leave Costco without spending $300.
Great description of two other brands that are really just niching themselves and doing it fantastically. And a great example too. Thank you for sharing those numbers for us. I think our listeners would really like to hear that. The $37 average basket and how Costco is the $300 store. I mean, that's success right there. And your explanation of that was really interesting.
Thank you.
Well, we've talked about two really great brands. Can you describe your personal brand and leadership philosophy for us?
Yes, my personal brand is to excel above best. So it's important to never settle with just being comfortable or complacent, because then you're not going to grow, and you're not going to grow your market share. And my niche is to help others identify that they have become complacent, and to have, you know, to take a look with a new set of eyes and look at, you know, if you're always doing what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always got, right? So with a fresh set of eyes, what we do is we just analyze every aspect of your business and take a look at what are your weaknesses. Once you can recognize your weaknesses and humble yourself to accept your weaknesses, then you can come up with a strategy to capitalize on your strengths and remove those weaknesses and really grow your market share. So my brand is just helping others not just accept best, but become better than their best and take it to the next level for success.
Becoming better than your best. That's fantastic. And, you know, I really do believe in, and I like the way you were talking about not only identifying your strengths and your weaknesses, but being humble enough to accept them so that you can move forward to better your best.
Yeah, it really does cause, you know, everybody always likes to think they're doing everything really good and nobody really likes criticism.
Yeah.
But how are you supposed to grow unless you are willing to accept some criticism? I have a client that I worked with, code design in the European Union, and they're a digital marketing media company. And I did some consulting for them with a team, and we went in and we just analyzed them from one end to the other. And then we sat down with, you know, their presidents and their leaders, and, you know, we give you the good, the bad, and the ugly. But we also give you a great plan for moving forward and getting past some of your barriers. And one of their barriers was how to break out of the European market and break into the American marketplace. You know, what are some of the barriers there? Once again, you know, we really just had to identify demographics, the roles they play, demographics, how they apply it in the EU is much different than, you know, how they apply in our American marketplace. So try to go to market the same way you go to market in Europe. You're not going to have much success. You're going to have some barriers that you hit when you're coming into the US marketplace. So, you know, helping them identify that, but then giving them a strategy to build their brand is, you know, something that I really enjoy doing. When I was at Stater Brothers, I headed up the development of the Cleo and Leo brand. And if you've ever had the delicious cookies from there or cakes, it was just a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun to take a brand and set the guardrails for it. And you just really set, what are you going to do with it? How are you going to go to market with it? What is your message to your consumer? What do you want them seeing and what are they seeing? So you can think that your consumer views you one way, but having a fresh set of eyes look at it, you know, sometimes you can say, well, I didn't realize we were coming off like that. You know, we thought we were this, but you can help redirect and reposition them to have forward momentum and grow their market share.
Yeah, that's really interesting. And how that's part of your personal brand and your leadership is great too, because I think giving criticism is a skill and it's something that really allows the people that you're leading to grow. I know I had a phone call early this morning, 8 o'clock with a client, and I said, you know, tell me, really, be transparent with me. What are some of the things that we're doing right now that we could be doing better? And he shared with me a couple of things that were very enlightening and some things that we really thought we were doing well. And so now I can bring that back to the team and say, you know, if we just pivot just slightly, we're going to be right on point. And so you just don't know. And I always say, you know, I'd rather you tell us than tell the next agency. So, you know, I think having frank conversations and hearing criticism and being able to incorporate that into your brand and your next step is really, it's a great leadership philosophy.
It's so wise too. I used to tell my team when I was at Stater Brothers, we, you know, any ideas that we had, you know, just when we were all together, I call it a round table. We'd have a round table meeting and I said, there's nothing that you can say in here that's wrong. There's nothing that can't be criticized. I would much rather you criticize it here, beat it up, kick the tires, do whatever you can to it, say whatever you're thinking, because you're not going to hurt my feelings. You're going to make us better.
Right.
So that is just such a good approach that you took to just, you know, take it back to the team and make it a team effort and ask for their feedback. What do you see? What do you think? And let them tell you the ugly stuff without getting hit over the head. You know, that's, most people won't speak up in industry generally because you don't want to be a yes man. That's what I used to tell my team. I don't want, you know, I don't want people that just say yes. I want you to tell me what you think because I value your opinion. And together, it's like a diamond, you know, you have different facets that, you know, reflect, and that's how you get that perfection. So when you, with through inclusion of your team, you really do put forward your best product.
A skill well-developed, giving criticism and taking it as well.
Yeah.
Great lesson. Great lesson you taught us here today. Melissa, could you talk about a personal learning experience, maybe a time or a situation in your career where you faced a professional obstacle and how you overcame it?
Yes, I have a great one you probably recognize it since you were in the grocery industry that, you know, it was predominantly male for majority of years.
Yes.
And I would say maybe in the last decade it has shifted, but working in a male dominated field was tough. You know, you really had to prove yourself that you knew what you were talking about in order to be respected, because there was a tendency to kind of stereotype you that, oh, you don't know. And I'll give you an example. I was on the committee for designing the new store decor at Stater Brothers Markets. And so there was a team of us that went out and we researched and, you know, just came up with a marketing strategy, a marketing plan, how we were going to go to market. And then one of the items that was on the list was the floors. So mm-hmm. we wanted to change the floors to, you know, a shopping experience that would be warm and inviting. And mm-hmm. our store floors and most store floors were hospital white, shiny tiles. You know, you walk in and you see them buffing the floors and they're super shiny and they're white. And to me, I just said, those look like a hospital. Like you're going into an emergency room. I go, that's not a warm look. So as we were giving our feedback to the executive team, it's like, you can't touch the floors. Everybody's like, no, don't, you can bring up anything. Don't bring up the floors. You can't touch the floors. I'm like, yeah, we got to touch the floors. We got to change. So that's horrible. It looks like a hospital. Okay. It's supposed to be warm and inviting. Right. And so there was some challenges with that. Well, I finally get everybody to agree. Okay. We'll consider changing the floors. Okay. We'll consider changing the floor color. Well, then I run across the construction team, go to the construction team and the head of construction is going to be doing the changes. We can't change those floors. I'm like, I got through all these other layers and now I can't change the floor because your construction is going to say, I can't. So I convinced retail. I convinced everybody that this would be good. You know, the material was a wood plank look. And so it was going to reduce fall slips and falls. It wouldn't be, you know, so it was wise for, you know, multiple reasons besides just aesthetics. Right. And so, he shut it down in a meeting. We were in a big, large meeting and he shut it down. And I just thought, but he's wrong. He's wrong. I don't believe he's saying that the floors won't hold up. So what I did mm-hmm. was I reached out to a designer and I said, can you give me contacts on three different, you know, flooring companies? And I'd like to do some research. So what I did was I went ahead and I went and did all kinds of research on floors and, you know, how much wear and tear they would have and what the, you know, life would be of it, because construction guy said, oh, these won't last, but, you know, just a couple years, we'll be ripping them out and you're going to cost us a ton of money at the company. And I thought, oh no, I don't believe you. So I researched it all. And then when we had the next meeting, when I walked into that meeting, I came in with all of the data and I was able to resurrect that challenge and say, okay, I'd like us to discuss the floors again. And he looks at me, I told you we can't do the floors. And then he goes through his whole thing and in front of an audience. And, you know, that was a bit of a challenge. You're like, sure, better be able to be right. And when I stated the facts, no, these floors will hold up. These floors will actually have a longer shelf life. They're going to take, you know, we're not going to have to spend the funds on all the buffing that we had to spend and all the stripping and the wax layers and everything else. And it's going to help with, you know, our liabilities on slip and falls. And here's all of your proof.
Wow.
His jaw hit the ground and he goes, okay, we'll try it. So I'm happy to say that it was so successful and it did meet all the metrics that we had anticipated. Right. And what it did for our insurance department on liabilities reducing them was just dramatic. And we were just, it's been real successful to where we're putting those floors in all stores now, even going back and putting them in. And it's like more than just the aesthetics. It was, you know, a good opportunity to update our look and make improvements for our bottom line.
Well, I think that that is just a fantastic example of getting around a professional obstacle too. And I think I liken that to what I like to call a rebound, you know, because you came up against a wall and boy, did you do your homework and the data and the information that you found out, not only is it aesthetically pleasing, but all of the other pluses that you pointed out to the company. I mean, yay. What a hero. Well,
I can also share with you that what was funny was when we would go into purchase new stores or build new stores and we would design them, they used to just take, okay, here's this look and we're just going to do the same exact thing. And the last few years that I was at the company, my relationship built so well, because I believe that even though you don't agree with somebody, you have to agree to disagree.
Sure.
And do it in a positive manner to where you're working with them as partners. And
yes.
So I built one of the best relationships with that guy. And it got to the point whenever we were in the designing point where he would just hand me over the plans and say, go ahead, draft it out however you want to lay it out. And I would, you know, it's like, oh, I'm going to put the ovens here. I want the, you know, and I could change anything with the drafting. He had that much confidence in my ability to work with him as a partner by the time he retired. So, you know, you could take something that was a weakness and a challenge and you can make it a strength.
Wow. And I think that's part of going back to what you started off telling us about is that you have two ears and one mouth. So you were listening to him and you came back with a strategy and then he listened to you. So boy, that is really the epitome of teamwork. What a great team you guys forged.
Yes, yes. It really, you know, that corny line, teamwork makes the dream work. Yeah.
There you go. Oh, wow. That was a great example. Well, let's stay on this kind of topic, maybe moving towards mentoring. Can you tell us a little bit about what mentoring has meant to you through your whole successful career? What is it, 30 years in this company, learning and growing? Anything that you want to share with us about how it helped you become the successful business person you are today?
Yes, I would. And I think that first we must recognize we could be mentored from anybody from any level. So although you always look up for mentoring, you should sometimes look at the people that are around you or even below you, because they're, you know, there was a lady that worked underneath me, but she was such a sweet and caring person and listened to individuals so often that she made you want to have that same type of empathy and care for everyone. So that was a good mentoring model. But also I'll go back to the late, great Jack Brown. He was such a nice guy. He had a mom. His mom was widowed when he was 7 years old. His father was a sheriff and she was widowed. And so she raised him on her own and she worked two jobs. And he used to say, I could get sometimes dinner was egg salad on saltine crackers because mom worked hard. Mm-hmm. But once he was 12 years old, he went to work too so that he could help out with the household. And so he had a soft spot in his heart for women in the workplace because of his mother. And so although the industry as a whole was male dominated, Jack had, he didn't believe in giving a hand out. He believed in giving a hand up. And so he would give you a fair opportunity, just like anybody else in the company. I knew that, you know, if I wanted to move up in the company, I needed to refine my skill set. And so I continued to pursue my education to enhance my skill set. And then also take on challenges within the company and different aspects that didn't fall under my helm to grow. And what that would cause interaction with Jack sometimes. He would call up and he would never give you the whole answer of what he was asking. He'd just call you up and he'd give you just a little bit. He'd speak in like a kind of a riddle sometimes. He'd call you up and he goes, If you're in a hole, quit digging. And you say, well, what do you mean by that? You tell me what I mean by that. Well, can I have some time to think about that and get back to you? So he would do that on a regular basis. He would challenge his people and he would, if he saw you were doing something that you were getting a little off track, he wanted you to identify it. So he wouldn't tell you what it was. He'd cause you to self-reflect, bring it back to him, and then he'd coach you on how to move forward. And so that was a great model. And it taught me the importance of doing that with my team. You know, if you tell everybody what they're doing wrong, they can't think on their own. They'll never, you'll be babysitting all day long. But if you teach people how to grow and you coach them, then they'll self-improve and it's going to complement you and your operation. And so he taught me that mentoring style. And so I continued to use that same mentoring style for multiple persons that I worked with in industry to help them grow as individuals. And I was grateful for the personal growth I got from him and grateful to pass it forward.
Wow. It's just some great mentoring stories. Number one, the first lesson is that we can be mentored from anybody, above, below, equal. There's lessons to be learned all over. And I really love the lesson that Jack taught you in the riddles. That's great. And you know, In a male-dominated industry, some of our best male allies have had really strong female examples in their life. And so the story that you told us about Jack and his mother, it really helps us to understand how he became such a great mentor to you. So thank you.
Oh, you bet. He also had three daughters, no sons. So I think he was, you know, inclined to be a little bit better trained than most.
Oh, he was a girl dad.
Yes.
Right? That's our new term, thanks to Kobe. He was a girl dad.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I'm really curious to know what the transition has been for you after 30 years at Stater Brothers and now into your own consulting business, MRG Consulting. What kind of obstacles and challenges are you helping your clients with in 2020?
Well, I think that the transition for me has been an exciting one. You know, when you work within the structure of a company, you still have the structure of the company, you know, you have limitations on, you know, how far you can take something and how fast you can go with it or how big. So there's a lot of freedom in, you know, becoming an entrepreneur to where you can take it to whatever level you desire. And it's pretty neat how you can create a business plan that encompasses all that you believe in and what you want to share with others. And one of the areas that I've found is teaching leadership. I think leadership is something that no matter what business you're in, it's critical that you teach people how to be leaders. And there's an arc, you know, at the University of the Redlands, we call it the arc of purposeful leadership. And it takes you through the steps of, you know, self and teams and working in organizations and then incorporating all of that into the society that you're in to give back. And being a purposeful leader in business means that, you know, when I'm doing business with a company, I'm helping teach them how to be purposeful leaderships. And when you do that arc of purposeful leadership, you really do on self-management, it's your character, your competence, your commitment, your compassion. For team management, it's clear team purpose, it's empowerment, it's skills and performance, it's trust. And then from an organizational management standpoint, it's a clear mission and strategy, alignment of strengths and resources, performance-driven change management, supportive culture. And then finally, you take that to a society value proposition and, you know, your corporate responsibility principles and practices and your community engagement and philanthropy. When you take a look at that, that's what my brand brings forward to my clients, is that I'm going to help you complete that whole arc. And that is what is really going to make you successful. If you're missing pieces, if you don't have, a platform for charity, you know, that's you're missing a part of your business, and people want to see who you are and what you represent. And so I think all of that is important, not just, okay, you have one problem, I'm going to help you with that one little thing. I think you need to look at the whole, you know, purposeful leadership concept.
Wow. I mean, that I think that's really special, and I think it's unique. And I think in bringing all of your experience, everything that you learned, and being so involved with a company that it seemed had a purpose as well, I think that's just some wonderful consultation that you can bring to your clients. And it's pretty special. The Arc of Leadership, is that what you called it?
Yes, it's the University of Redlands Arc of Leadership concept.
It.
And being a member of the Whitehead Leadership, I'm involved with the university a lot and giving back and speaking at some of their different forums and interacting with, you know, helping mentor and grow individuals forward. And I really do believe in the principles that are that stand behind that concept. I think it's right on target. Having come from the, you know, a large organization, the real life, and then tying that to academia, It is on target. It's not like, okay, you're way out there on the left field, you know.
Right.
You have to be able to branch it together. And I do really, really think it's right on point.
Yeah, you do. You can't just be all the way out there on the edge. You have to be able to tie it back to business and show yes. how it's been used successfully.
Yes.
And I think that you bring that well-rounded point of view to this. And I think that's what makes it so valuable.
Thank you.
I'd love to share that. Maybe if you will send that to me, we can put it specially on the website so people can click through and take a look at that, because I think it's fascinating.
Absolutely.
I think people would like to know some more about that. Just a couple more questions. I just want to thank you so much for all the lessons that you have shared with us today. It's been such a great mentoring experience, you mentoring us today and sharing all your valuable experience. It's been great. And I'm wondering if there's anything, you know, any kind of advice that you might give to women who are looking to excel with their goals today in the workplace, anything specific you might let us know about?
Yeah, I think it's important to be visible. And I say that in a way, not in to be visible with your strengths. So it's important that you keep learning, and that you keep learning in all different channels of your business. So, you know, continue to pursue your education, continue to keep your skill set fresh, but also speak up when you're in meetings. Be visible. Don't. I think females have a tendency to, especially in a male-dominated environment, be quiet or not speak up. And I think that they need to have a certain amount of confidence and boldness. I think look them in the eye, shake their hand, and speak up, speak your opinion. If you don't agree with something, you need to explain why, and you need to be well equipped enough to explain why. Like I gave you the example of when it came to the floors, I did the research so that whatever his concerns were, I was able to prove to him it's not a problem. Okay. What you think is going to happen isn't, because here's the proof that it's not. So, just being very well researched is important. But I also think that one of the things is to, if you want to be an executive, you need to dress and look the part. So don't, if you have plans of being a VP someday, don't come to work with your hair in a ponytail and you just pulled whatever out of it. You need to look sharp. You need to dress professional. You need to have a professional image. Look at your wardrobe, look at your, it's better to dress for the position you want. You want to be an executive, dress like one. I think that that's so important, because a lot of times younger women might get caught up on a fashion, with like, oh, we've got, big flashy hot pink earrings that are hanging, and yeah, it might be cute, but does it really look like the executive that's in the executive office? So maybe just kind of like model what you're seeing at a hierarchy and try and apply that. And I think that to challenge your own personal barriers, prove yourself through results. So if you want to move forward, talk isn't going to cut it. You need to have concrete proof that you're the person that should move forward. So when you're dressing the way you should, you're helping them envision you in that position you want to be in. If you look the part, you're helping them see you in that position and in that role. If you're achieving results with where you're at and you're sharing those results, that helps build confidence in you as an individual. It shows that you're capable of whatever's brought before you, of being successful with it and growing on it. And so you want to continue when you have a success. Don't go for the easy way out. Go for the hard challenges. If there's projects that need to be done, take on the hardest one and then be successful with it, because that'll speak volumes more than you can verbally say for yourself.
Such solid advice. Be visible. Keep learning and look the part.
Yeah.
Excellent advice. Wow. I'm wondering, do you have a habit or two that contributes to your success? What do you do on a regular basis?
I think that the key to success is life balance. I think that it's really, and I learned this when I was young, when I was climbing the corporate ladder, I was so focused on a perfect GPA at a certain point when I was going to college and focused on doing everything, to the highest level, that I really stepped away from exercising and watching, what I eat or getting enough sleep. And all of a sudden I noticed that, you know what? I'm not making as sharp of decisions as I could or should. I'm not as quick on my feet. And so luckily I learned that at a young point in my career was life balance, that you have to have proper rest. Make sure that you're self-disciplined to where you go to sleep and get a decent amount of sleep, and that you exercise. I exercise 5 days a week, sometimes six. And even if it's just, you're traveling, if it's getting out and walking, but you're taking care of yourself. That's good for you mentally. It's good for you physically. And then eating healthy also keeps you, feeling good. And then most importantly, you have to have the proper time with your family. If you don't have that life balance, I'm a mother and a grandmother.
No, you're not. You are not a grandmother.
Thank you.
I'm looking at you.
But I didn't want to miss out on, I didn't want to have a career and say I missed out on life and yeah. I didn't get to see my kids or my grandkids. So I made sure that through self-discipline, I left work at work when I should, and I rested when I should. I was healthy. And I had quality time with my family. And when you're like that, you don't have any emotional, issues going on because you're taking care of your family. You're interactive with your family. And a lot of women sometimes will lose that balance. So it's important to balance that out, have life balance. And once you do, then when you're at work, you're at your optimum. You are just really a strong performer. And it's...
Yeah. And I would imagine the same at home too. If you're doing all those things, by the time you do get home, you're available for your family because you're not exhausted and you've exercised and you're eating right.
Yeah.
So you're in the right frame of mind to enjoy all aspects of your life. I think that's just fabulous advice.
Well, I think time management is probably a key point because I used to tell my team whenever I'd promote somebody up new, okay, for the first year, I'll give you some grace on this. But after 1 year, if I see that you have to habitually come in early or habitually work through your lunch or habitually stay late, you're not using good time management. You're working harder, not smarter. And so I want to coach you on working smarter. And if you find yourself at that point, come to me because I'm going to teach you how to utilize your time better to where it's more effective. And when you do that, when you use good time management skills at work and at home, you learn to cut the fat off the things that eat up time.
Hmm.
And interfere. And then you just come up with a structure that is a quality structure that allows you to be efficient and productive in the least amount of time possible, maximizing your time.
Good advice. I know I'm going to self-assess when we're done with this. Better time management. We could all use that advice. Melissa, you've been such a fantastic guest. Thank you so much. I just have one more question. Do you have any books or podcasts, anything that you'd recommend to our listeners?
You're going to find this really corny, but I do. I really think that if you look online and you get some of the books, the older books from Dale Carnegie, I think those are some of the strongest tools for anybody going into the workplace.
Wow. A throwback to Dale Carnegie. I mean, yeah, just, the best, right?
There was one example when I was in, I'd been in supervision for maybe about a year, and I showed up in it was a retail operations meeting, and I was just delivering some stuff that they were going to hand out at that meeting, for my division. And there was probably like 40, 50 people there. And the vice president said, "Oh, Melissa, I'm so glad you're here. We'd like you to be a guest speaker today." I was not prepared to be a guest speaker that day. And I was like, I just wanted to die. So as he's telling me this, I could feel the sweat, starting to bead on the back of my head. And I'm going, really, I must get going. I didn't put this in my schedule. I'm trying to weasel out of it. And all of a sudden I feel the trickle of sweat dripping down my back. I'm not getting out of this. And so I get called out on the floor to do this, speech that I was not prepared for. And I went back to the principles of Dale Carnegie. And what was funny was my husband was the one that went to Dale Carnegie. I didn't, but he brought the books home. And so when I couldn't sleep, I was reading the books and it was like, how to speak effectively, And so I was reading some of his books and all of a sudden I thought, okay, the principles, just get in there and do it. I went in there and I applied the principles and it went so smooth. I was asked to come back and speak on a regular basis and ended up becoming a speaker many a times at, company functions for our company. because it taught me the tools that I needed to have confidence and be able to get through that. So I would just highly recommend, you know, going through some of his books. They're a little outdated, but the principles were just great. And they're also very entertaining. They're pretty fun. It's a little bit of a time travel.
Wow. I love that. I'm definitely going to go back. Hopefully, I wonder if they have to have those on tape now, right? Because I love books on tape.
I'll research a couple of my favorites and send those to you.
Yes, yes. I'm a huge Audible fan, so I would love to listen to that. And I know that Ian's laughing because we listen to audiobooks and podcasts all the time. So that's great advice. Thank you.
Yeah.
Very unique. Well, you are definitely an articulate speaker, and you've been a great guest and a fabulous mentor to us, and a great example of a female leader that we should all keep our eye on. So thank you for joining us on the Showrunner Marketing Podcast.
Thank you so much, Kathy. I appreciate the privilege of spending time with you and your team.
Oh, it was fun. Thanks, Melissa.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
That's our show for today. Our latest interview and show notes have been added to our Showrunner Hall of Fame at the ShowrunnerMarketingPodcast.com. Don't miss an episode by subscribing now to the Showrunner Marketing Podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, or Google Play. And to network, motivate, and gain some more wisdom from the top, follow Advanced Marketing Strategies on Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, Instagram, and LinkedIn. Keep learning and growing. And thanks for listening.